Hello and welcome. I'm Peter Afrasiabi, the host of The Curious Lawyer. Real quick, what is The Curious Lawyer? It's a series of educational and entertaining continuing legal education programs that are off the beaten path, something a little bit outside your normal lane that you may practice in. This is definitely not boring, static content. It's super engaging, super interesting, it's light, it's fun, and it's educational. It allows us to take different issues from society, from history, from current political issues, for example, and see how they intersect with the law. And so we've done a program, for example, on dog law, where you get to take your favorite furry friends and see what happens with our dogs when we start looking at trust and estate law, at contract law, tort law, and the like. We've done CIA law, where you get to find out the famous phrase, I can neither confirm nor deny, where it comes from. Turns out it comes from the legal arena. And of course, we did a program on Yellowstone and whether there's a little sliver of land in Yellowstone National Park that because of the conflicts of the Sixth Amendment and some congressional acts, is it potentially a crime-free zone where you could murder someone and get away with it? Don't do it, but I'm not gonna tell you the answer to the questions. You gotta go watch the program. Today, of course, we're taking the issue of John F. Kennedy and his assassination and the aftermath. And we are seeing how that intersects with the law. But before we start, let me stand and deliver on this. I am not going to tell you who killed John F. Kennedy. It is beyond the scope of my knowledge. It's beyond the scope of this program. That said, we're going to look at some of the different theories from the Warren Commission Report's lone assassin theory through to what was, you know, heavily publicized and turned into a great movie by Oliver Stone in terms of the multiple assassin theory. All of that stuff is going to come up today as we explore this. But we're going to explore that and so much more. We are going to look substantively at copyright and fair use to start. And as you see here on our slide of our agenda, I'm going to double click for you and walk you through where we're going today. From a copyright perspective, we're going to talk about John F. Kennedy, and you're going to get to explore copyright fair use law. We're going to look at the Zapruder film, the famous, famous film. We're going to look at issues of authorship. And since we're talking about President John F. Kennedy, we're going to look at some political speeches and public use of those speeches to understand how and when we can use those speeches ourselves. Are they public domain? Are they free to use? Do we have to pay a license fee and the like? We, of course, are going to look at Garrison's prosecution of Clay Shaw. I assume you all know what it is from the movie or from D.A. Garrison's book On the Trail of the Assassins, but ultimately it led to a huge prosecution after the trial in the movie of Clay Shaw for perjury, and that leads to questions about prosecutorial overreach that we will explore. We are going to look at a couple sidebars today. One of them will include First Amendment and copyright, and we're going to look at the issue of the Kennedy family and paparazzi, and turns out the first paparazzi case in American history. We'll also talk about Fifth Amendment's takings, which will bring us back to the Zapruder film. And we're also going to look at a case involving Oswald's rifle and government takings. This, of course, will bring us more to the modern day, where we will get to the JFK Records Act. And we're going to look at the assassination records that are in the government files and coffers. We're going to look at litigation that's been over access to those records, the scope of access. And we're going to look at issues about the difficulty of even when you win in terms of getting records, how you get fees against the government. And we're gonna have a fun little antitrust sidebar where we'll do a quick primer on antitrust law and sports, and we're gonna look at the JFK Sports Broadcasting Act of 1961. Let's get going with some copyright basics. Copyright gives the author of an original work fixed in a tangible medium. And I've bolded those words for you because those are going to be the little windows we parachute in on as we do our JFK assassination copyright exploration today. But it gives the author of an original work fixed in a tangible medium certain exclusive rights: the right to reproduce, make derivatives, distribute publicly the work, perform publicly, publicly display, and the like. So the question then is, what is an original work? And there's a very low bar to originality within the law. It must simply be original to the source with a minimal degree of creativity. It's extremely low. That's the words of the Supreme Court you see there. And here's a famous quote from the Blystein case from 1903, which is still good law, controlling law when it comes to this inquiry. It would be a dangerous undertaking for persons trained only to the law to constitute themselves final judges of the worth of pictorial illustrations outside of the narrowest and most obvious limits. At one extreme, some works of genius would be sure to misappreciation. At the other end, copyright would be denied to pictures which appeal to a public less educated than the judge. That is the standard. Now, as you'll see, we're going to talk about what does it mean to be fixed in a tangible medium. And on this page here of our next slide, you see a picture there of a book, The Strategy of Peace by John F. Kennedy. It's the cover, a photograph of the cover of the book. And that is how things get fixed in a tangible medium. They get permanently recorded or reduced to form in some manner. You put pen to paper, for example, you type on the keyboard to your computer, you create source code, you draw, you paint, you sculpt. The key though is it must be fixed in a tangible medium. Skywriting doesn't count. So, what types of works get copyright protection? Well, you see on our slide here, I've got a list of different types of works that intersect copyright law and are entitled to copyright protection. One of which, of course, is film, and there you see a snapshot of the film for the Zapruder film, which we'll be talking about momentarily. But copyright, of course, is broader than film. It includes books and other writings, music, photographs, artwork, software and source code, architecture, clothing designs even, pantomimes, choreographs, and the like, film. Anything ultimately that can be original to the author, fixed in a tangible medium, and subject to other exceptions that may exist if we start talking about utilitarian works, for example. But it's very, very broad copyright in terms of what it touches. We're going to look at now the issue of framing ownership versus fair use. And we're going to look at the battle between the exclusive right that belongs to the author of a work, such as Zapruder in his film. And we're going to look then at the right of others to use that, the fair use right of other people to use it without compensating Mr. Zapruder or his family. So let's start with the copyright clause of the Constitution. It is to promote the progress of science and useful arts. Now, there's no textual provision for fair use in the Constitution, but it came as part of the common law from England. And so how do we figure out what is this sort of fair use analysis? Well, you see here in a famous quote from old law, which has sort of now made its way into codified law, but we have Justice Story back in 1841 in the case of Folsom v. Marsh, where he says we have to look to the nature and objects of the selections made, the quantity and value of the materials used, the degree to which it may prejudice someone else's ability to sell or supersede the objects of the original work. Now, you also have another quote from him that's very, very important in terms of the fair use analysis, and I put it in yellow here because this is a very, very famous quote that keeps repeating itself throughout the ages, throughout the generations in copyright law. And it's the subject of the eye of the beholder as to whether you believe it or not. But in truth, in literature, in science, and in art, there are and can be very few, if any, things which, in an abstract sense, are strictly new and original throughout. Every book in literature, science, and art borrows and must necessarily borrow and use much which was well known and used before. And that's a famous issue in terms of, or quote, in terms of how we frame this issue of what's really new and original versus what isn't. All right, so let's fast forward to copyright and fair use today, because we've now moved from common law to codified law, as I've mentioned. And here you have the slide at 17 USC 107 that talks about the four factors we look at to figure out if something is a fair use. The purpose and character of the use, whether it's commercial or nonprofit, for example, the nature of the copyrighted work itself, the amount and substantiality of the portion used in relation to the copyrighted work as a whole, and then the effect on the potential market. And those are the critical factors that we are going to look at today. This brings us to the Zapruder film and fair use. So let's do this first. You see here on the slide, we got a picture of the book, 6 Seconds in Dallas. I remember reading it when I was a teenager in high school, loved it at the time. This is one of the first books dealing with the John F. Kennedy Warren Commission report and whether it was right or whether there really was a conspiracy of other people and other shooters. But you see here a picture of the book that's got some screenshots, stills taken from the Zapruder film. But let's start by watching this 38-second clip, which is of the Zapruder film. So let's go ahead and watch it. So the question then, now we've seen the Zapruder film, and you've all seen it, no doubt, from the JFK movie or from other sources. But the question that we have to first address when we're now going to talk about Zapruder and his copyright is, does he have a copyright in that film? He was just standing there holding a camera, filming a car driving by with the president and Governor Connally and the president's wife and other Secret Service agents and the like. I mean, do you have a, you know, are you an author? Do you have a copyright in that? And the answer is yes. He filmed it. It was original to him, and it meets that originality standard. And remember, it's a very, very low bar. You may think that just holding up a camera and, you know, holding it as someone walks past you is unoriginal or not very creative, but not so within the law. There's a very low standard. Someone's got to pick the angle, the location, the lighting. You know, those decisions are creative and original to the author, and that means Zapruder had a copyright in his specific film that he filmed. So what happened then that brings us to this fair use battle we're about to talk about? Well, here are the facts. Time went and bought the film from Zapruder in 1963, and they did this within days of the assassination. A few years later, a person by the name of Thompson, who is ultimately the defendant in the case, he writes a 1967 book, and it's published by a company called Geiss, and it's called 6 Seconds in Dallas, and there you see it again on the right-hand side. And so what Thompson and Geiss then published it. What they did was they have this book and they talk about, you know, what they think happened. And they took stills from the Zapruder film and they truncated them a little bit and they put them in the book. And you see there on the lower, I put a picture of on the lower right-hand corner of some of these still shots from the Zapruder film. Now they are in black and white and not color. And here's an important fact to also remember. The Zapruder film that we're all familiar with, it wasn't even seen by the public as a film until the mid-1970s when Geraldo Rivera somehow got a copy of it and showed it on one of his television shows at the time. And that's when the public first actually saw the film. Before that, the public had only ever seen stills that came out of the film that were published by Time Life magazine. The Warren Commission, of course, had the original and they all watched the film, but the public hadn't seen it. And so this book is then published. And there was at the time a lot of public criticism of the Warren Commission in terms of what was going on. And so the book is published to raise the issue about, you know, could it really be the case that Oswald killed him alone? And some of the arguments and evidence turn on stills taken from the Zapruder film where you see John F. Kennedy's head being hit and exploding and whatnot. And people then discussing what that means in terms of where the shooter was. Could it really have come from the front? And if it came from the front, then Oswald didn't act alone and whatnot. So in any event, he publishes his book in 1967 and has those still shots in it. Time, of course, at this point had acquired the rights and they weren't happy. And so they sue for copyright infringement of the film, claiming that those still images come from the copyright. We bought the copyright from the Zapruder family at the time. For a limited time. They were to then return it at some point in the future, but they currently were the copyright owners. And their position was, this is copyright infringement. And so this brings us, as you see on our next slide here, to the case of Time versus Geiss, reported at 293 F Sup 130 in the Southern District of New York in 1968. And basically, originally the defendants went to get permission and Time said no. So they said, well, we're going to print them anyway. We think this is fair use. And we think we have the right to do this. And so the question is, remember those fair use factors? This is actually before those fair use factors were codified in the late 70s, but they were the same factors being used within a common law analysis at the time. Is it fair use? Well, here's what the district court in New York held under the first factor. There's a public interest in having the fullest information available on the murder of President Kennedy. Thompson did serious work on the subject and has a theory entitled to public consideration. While doubtless the theory could be explained with sketches of the type used at page 87 of the book and in the Saturday Evening Post, the explanation actually made in the book with copies is easier to understand. The book is not bought because it contained the Zapruder pictures. The book is bought because of the theory of Thompson and its explanation supported by the Zapruder pictures. How much was used? Well, he didn't use all the frames that had been publicly released by Time Life magazine at the time. They also weren't in color and they were also cropped a little bit too. So the court said, as to the amount used, not a whole lot. And then on the market effect, this is what the district court held. The book was not in competition. Time wasn't selling these pictures, actually. It wasn't in the market of selling them. And so there was no market in other words, for its copyrighted sort of interest to be impacted. And the actual quote from the court is, it seems more reasonable to speculate that the book would, if anything, enhance the value of the copyrighted work. It is difficult to see any decrease in its value. And so what the court held was that that use by someone writing a serious work in a book on whether, you know, President Kennedy was actually assassinated by a lone gunman or not, was a fair use of the Zapruder film. And so, you know, he as an author had the right to use it because he met the fair use test. So that's how fair use and copyright works. As we start looking at the Zapruder film, don't worry, we're going to come back to Zapruder and his film in all manner of ways soon. But real quick, let's stay on copyright. Now we're going to shift to copyright and authorship. And we're going to use this to explore, since we're talking about JFK and the law today, JFK's presidential speeches. And we're going to get to the issue we talked about earlier. Who's an author? Well, the author is the one that creates the original work, and they own the copyright. But, as you see on our slide here, talking, and there's a picture of John F. Kennedy giving his speech, there's an exception for federal creations in the course of federal employment. And this is under 17 U.S.C. section 105A. And so it exempts the U.S. government from receiving and holding copyrights. So let's run a couple hypotheticals as we explore today copyright and JFK. And let's start by watching this about minute clip of President John F. Kennedy's famous moon speech. Here we go.
But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why, 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the others too.
This speech was written by John F. Kennedy and his speechwriters, and they were all doing it within their government duties. This was an official speech he went off and gave. And so what that means under Section 105 is that President Kennedy or the other federal employees who wrote that speech do not own a copyright in it, because under 105A, they're not able to. Now, remember, we just watched a video recording. So the speech itself is written, there's no copyright. But what about that video recording? There may be a copyright in that. For example, if I was there attending and I recorded President Kennedy giving the speech, I'd have a copyright in my recording of that speech, even though I had no copyright in the audio, because the actual spoken words, in other words, belong to President Kennedy and I can't stop other people from using his words. But I would control the use of my specific video recording of it. But as it turns out here, NASA recorded that version. And so you can watch it, because both the video recording, the copyright in that, and the underlying audio recording are all done by the federal government. And so they all belong to us, the people, because the federal government cannot have a copyright under Section 105. And just so you know, that photograph came from NASA's website too, so that's safe too, as it was taken by NASA. No copyright interest. But let's do a contra case. And we're gonna shift actually to another speech, and we're gonna think about John F. Kennedy's brother, Robert F. Kennedy, on our next speech here. And so we'll start by watching this short 20-second odd clip of a speech given by Robert F. Kennedy at the Democratic National Convention in 1964, talking about his then-deceased brother. So let's watch this clip.
We dedicate ourselves, as he frequently did, to all of you when he spoke, when he quoted from Robert Frost and said that apply to himself, but that we could really apply to the Democratic Party and to all of us as individuals. That the woods are lovely, dark, and deep, but I have promises to keep, and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep.
So there you saw that snippet of the speech given by Robert F. Kennedy. So let's do our copyright analysis as we run through this hypothetical. So we'll start with assuming that Robert F. Kennedy wrote the speech, I don't actually know, but let's just assume he was. Well, at that time, he was not a federal employee, and even if he was, that was not a speech that was being given in his capacity as a federal employee. Remember, this was a speech as a political partisan participant at the Democratic National Convention. That's not sort of within the course and scope of one's federal employment. So by all sort of standards, Robert Kennedy would own the copyright to that speech he was given. But as you saw in the speech, he quoted now Robert Frost's famous poem, The Road Not Taken. So now we have sort of multiple layers of copyright issues here. We have Robert Kennedy giving a speech, but using someone else's poem within that speech. So let's figure out, let's assume that Robert Frost had a copyright in his poem. Would Robert Kennedy's use of The Road Not Taken meet a fair use analysis? Well, let's think about it. Let's go to the first factor. He only used a few lines out of the entire Road Not Taken poem. It was certainly not in competition for sale of the original. In other words, you wouldn't go and listen to this sort of 45-minute speech by Robert Kennedy in lieu of buying Robert Frost's The Road Not Taken. He was also using it to explain a major sort of philosophical political issue within the realm of his brother's assassination. And he wasn't using it for a commercial endeavor or profit because he was essentially eulogizing his brother. And so it would meet a fair use test, and Robert Kennedy would not be liable to Robert Frost if Robert Frost was so inclined to complain. I doubt he was, because as you probably all know or remember from our history, Robert Frost spoke at John F. Kennedy's inauguration where he gave a poem to the country. And now, small note, Frost's poem was from 1915. And so assuming he had complied with all the copyright formalities of that era, it would have actually been in copyright when Robert Kennedy spoke in 1964. But today, that snippet that you listen to of The Road Not Taken, we can all use it fairly because, and quote it and write it, draft it, whatnot, put it in a book, because it's out of copyright. It's now public domain. It's exceeded the life of copyright. Let's do a sidebar now, as we're gonna shift, staying in the realm of copyright and First Amendment, but we're gonna talk a little bit about John F. Kennedy's family. And this is the case of Gaia versus Kennedy Onassis, coming from the Second Circuit in the early 70s. And basically what we're confronting is Gaia was a photographer following the family around, taking photographs. And there you see one of the ones he took that's at issue in the litigation of the Kennedy kids and Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis at the time. And they weren't happy. And so the Secret Service sort of arrested him and detained him. He ended up suing. She countersued then for state torts and sought an injunction and got one, prohibiting him from, doing what he was doing, which was, sort of like a fly, hovering over them everywhere publicly. And so the issue then that was raised is there a First Amendment issue with respect to this injunction against his activities in public? And so here's what the Second Circuit said. And we start by the Second Circuit. This is sort of the fun, curious lawyer fact about where paparazzi comes from. This is the first case dealing with it in America. And it actually talked about how, what is a paparazzi? Well, Newsweek called it an annoying bug. Literally a kind of annoying insect, perhaps roughly equivalent to the English word gadfly. So that's where they start by framing even what is a paparazzi. And then they emphasize that the case didn't relate to a news photographer, a news reporter, a photojournalist trying to get a story about a woman and her children, who were an object of legitimate public interest. Instead, this was really about the behavior of other photographers and reporters and the attack of the paparazzi as they sort of were really sort of focusing in and zeroing in on the Kennedy family. And so here's the ruling you see on our final slide here. She was a public figure, and so she was subject to legitimate news coverage, but he went beyond the reasonable bounds of First Amendment news gathering. So there's this de minimis public interest, the court said, in sort of seeing what she's doing in her life, going about her business. But the scope of his surveillance, his obtrusive and intruding presence, was too unreasonable in their minds. And so an injunction on her state court claims was able to be issued because he went beyond the bounds of the reasonableness that the First Amendment will give to allow people engaged in news gathering and paparazzi behavior. So basically, it was unreasonable, unwarranted how far he went. And so It was just sort of too inexcusable to sort of be jumping in front of them and causing them to fall off their bikes and have accidents, all that type of stuff, right? And so that is our little sidebar on the First Amendment and the, where it intersects with copyright as folks are out photographing people like the Kennedys and JFK Jr. there in the press. This brings us back to Zapruder, and now we're going to also talk about Oswald, and we're going to shift and pivot right now to Fifth Amendment takings. So let's start on our next slide here with what does the Fifth Amendment taking clause say? Nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation. So how does this relate to Zapruder? Well, remember, that famous Zapruder film was licensed to Time for $150,000, and then they returned it back to him. After his death, the family had the copyright back, and they transferred into one of their companies. And the original actual film, though, this actual, the very, very film that came out of his camera was delivered to the National Archives for safekeeping. And over the years, they had copies of the film, and they licensed copies of the film, and they made around $900,000 as of the late 1990s licensing the film. For example, JFK movie that Oliver Stone made, it played a snippet of the Zapruder film. He had to pay license fees to the family to get that film to use for his commercial movie. So now here's what happened is, after the success of the movie John F. Kennedy, JFK in 1992, there was this whole law passed that we're going to talk about soon called the JFK Assassination Record Collection Act, because of a public outcry to figure out what's going on with the records that haven't been released. And so as a part of that law, the Assassination Research Records Board took possession of the original 8mm film. Quick mini sidebar, let's remember the distinction between copyright and then the actual medium in which the copyright exists. The Assassination Review Board didn't take the copyright. They just took the actual physical medium in which it was originally recorded. The family still owned the copyright, and they always did, and they owned copies of the film that they could then license. But they lost possession of that original, the very, very original film that Mr. Zapruder shot, you know, standing there on the grassy knoll. And so that film was taken, and so the heirs to Zapruder sued, saying, hey, you took our private property, that literal original, and we want it back. We want money. We can't get it back. The law's taken it under the act. It now belongs to the government. We're entitled to just compensation. So they all agreed to go to an arbitration, and here we see on the next slide, it's called In the Matter of the Zapruder Film, and it was decided July of 1999. And so the question, the legal question this raises is, how do you value an asset for just compensation purposes? What is just compensation? Well, the basic rule of law that three arbitrators decided it, but the rule of law they worked from comes from the U.S. Supreme Court, U.S. versus General Motors, and this is a case in 1945 coming out of the war effort. And basically, the U.S. took possession of a large GM lease for the war effort, its war effort. GM sues, and they have a battle over, you know, what's the value? The government said, well, it's the rental value of the lease based on the price per square foot. GM says, well, but we have all these other things we lost, like employee salaries. We had to pay for security to protect it, janitors. We had to pay shipping costs to get all materials out, all that type of stuff. Every one of those was overruled, and the trial court said, you only get rental rate. Now, this goes to the Supreme Court that reverses and says some of those costs can be considered in assessing the market values that parties would have set, but you can't get loss of, you know, goodwill or injury to the business by the act. So you don't get sort of the idea that you took our lease, we could have continued to make cars at X profit margin, we're entitled to that X profit margin. So the Zapruder family here says, look, this is a historical, iconic film. And they had expert appraisers who said, this thing's worth $25 to $30 million. And they used art and historical artifact appraisers and auctioneers who auctioned these types of historical collectability type things. One of the examples they gave was that the Da Vinci's original codex had sold for $30 million to Bill Gates. So that was their argument. They wanted $25 to $50 million, actually, based on those types of appraisers. And they said this original film is absolutely iconic. It's, well, like the Da Vinci Codex, basically. The government says, no, this is personal property. We never took the copyright. You had copies of it. You're able to make money from them. And you're only making $800,000 to $900,000 in the last 20 years. So it's not like it's highly, highly valuable. And so their position was it was worth about $1 million max. Now, they didn't bring auctioneer experts, as the Zapruder family did, and perhaps that was a mistake, because what the panel held is that it wasn't worth the $25, $30 that they were asking for, or the appraiser said, but they said it was worth $16 million. Now, the dissent here said, no, This thing was worth maybe $1 million, like the government expert said. And you should get sort of a multiple of maybe 3 to 5 on that because it was of historical interest. It was sort of an artifact of an iconic historical type thing. And so maybe you should get 3 to 5 million. But this idea that that someone would pay 15, 16 million, dissent just didn't buy. But the majority did, and that's probably because they brought auctioneer experts. As you read the opinion, it's pretty clear. And as a result of bringing the right experts, and so that's your practice point, if you're going to be fighting over just compensation, make sure you understand the market really, really well. Now, that said, the government paid 15, 16 million, and the government owns that iconic film now. I think we as a people did okay, because in this day and age, you see people selling bananas duct taped to a piece of canvas for $5 million, and we see all manner of things in this sort of world of endless numbers of billionaires and gazillionaires and millionaires and all that stuff. So I'm guessing one day the government could sell that for way more than the 15 or 16 million they had to pay. So I think we probably did okay as a people in terms of paying that asset for that price. Let's shift though from the Zapruder film to what you did not see on the Zapruder film, but you could hear, and that's Oswald's rifle. And this brings us to the takings case of King versus United States from the Fifth Circuit. And so basically what happened is as follows. Oswald's widow, Marina Oswald, sold her rights and his rifle to a Denver gun collector, a guy named John King. The government had the rifle, obviously, and they refused to return it after the Warren Commission, so he sued for unlawful takings and just compensation. It goes to the district court, and the district court holds, well, under federal gun laws, when Oswald bought that rifle, he used a fictitious name. He didn't write Lee Harvey Oswald, he wrote something else. And that was illegal under the federal law, and so the firearm transfer was void to begin with, and so she didn't even have an asset because it's all void. Now this goes up to the Fifth Circuit, and the Fifth Circuit reverses. It says, it would certainly be convenient, and it would tend to hasten the termination of what must appear to many to be a distressful bit of litigation were we able to accept the government's present theory and affirm the trial court's judgment forfeiting the weapons to the U.S. as a species of deodands. Deodands, of course, deodands, is the idea that, you know, if you sort of forfeit in some, you know, horrendous way, like you kill someone, you drop the weapon, you've given it up, you don't own it. But they said, you know, we can't kind of go there on that issue, on the idea, on that basic idea right on this record. And so they went through the Federal Firearms Act and they said, hey, look, you know, he ordered it through a legitimate licensed dealer. The legitimate licensed dealer didn't use a fictitious name, and so it doesn't really matter if Oswald used a different name. He had no basis to know that he had been breaking the law, and so we simply can't affirm on that. So it goes back to trial. So you may think at that point that this guy King now is excited. He's going to get his hands on the Oswald rifle, but they go to trial. The government says, no, we're not going to settle and give you that rifle, and we're not going to give you, you know, money. And at trial, the jury adopts the theory of abandonment. And they now adopt it factually, that Oswald abandoned it. When he shot, he dropped the rifle, and that act of dropping the rifle and leaving it in the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository, if indeed you believe Oswald was up there and did drop the rifle, one of the theories is he was, as he said, the patsy, and so he wasn't even the one shooting the rifle up there. But nonetheless, at this time and place, 1960s, the jury adopted necessarily the idea that Oswald was there and did the shooting, and that was his rifle. And so they said, nope, it's been abandoned. So, you know, it belongs to the government. Oswald abandoned it. His widow had nothing to assign away. And that's how takings works when it comes to Oswald's rifle. So the weapon, of course, no one's going to benefit by getting it. The film, Zapruder benefited. This brings us a little bit more to the modern era now, and we're going to talk about, which I know you all wanted to talk about, JFK the movie. And we're going to look at the Assassination Records Collection Act of 1992. Let's start, though, by watching this one-minute clip. Here we go. Thank you. So as you saw there, that was the ending scroll scene as the movie ended, and you saw the explanation that was given at the very end of the film about how many records were being hidden, why they're still being hidden, how outrageous this is. And you saw Kevin Costner, who played Garrison, sort of walk off into sort of the sunlight, bouncing off of the walls of the courtroom with his wife and son, you know, as sort of the, he had lost the trial, but was sort of the victorious noble hero as he walks off. We'll talk about that in a minute. But what happened after that film came out, it was a massive, massive movie. For those of you who were around like me then, you may remember it. And it prompted a massive public outcry. And the public outcry was in very, very intense. Congress people were sort of flooded with letters and demands that we need the records released, we need the records released. And so this led in 1992 to the passage of the Assassination Records Collection Act of 1992, also known as the JFK Act. And so now we're going to explore a little bit the JFK Act and see how this works and what's been going on. And so here's what the law posits and demands: that all government records related to the assassination of President John F. Kennedy should be preserved for historical and governmental purposes. That's Section 2A1. Number two, it requires that all government records concerning the assassination of President John F. Kennedy should carry a presumption of immediate disclosure, and all records should be eventually disclosed to enable the public to become fully informed about the history surrounding the assassination. Most of the records related to the assassination of President Kennedy are almost 30 years old. And so what they said, and this is Section 2A7, only in the rarest case is there any legitimate need for continuing protection of such records. And so a review board was created to go collect up from all the different government agencies all the records they had, and then manage a process of reviewing, analyzing, and then ultimately disclosing these records to the public. And the law demanded that this must be done within 25 years, by 2017, that is, unless, and here's the exception that's going to spawn some litigation that we're going to talk about soon, unless there's continued postponement of the record was necessary due to an identifiable harm to military defense, intelligence operations, or conduct of foreign relations that was of such gravity that it outweighed the public interest in the disclosure. And that's Section 5 of the Act. And so the idea then under this Section 5 is that everything must be released unless, for lack of a better word, perhaps we could use the idea of national security. There's some significant grave harm to military and our intelligence gathering operations, foreign relations, and whatnot that could be damaged if public disclosure occurs. And that Section 5 exclusion is very important because, you know, I remember back in 92 when the movie came out, you know, and then hearing about the act, and 91 maybe the movie was, but hearing about the act in 92 and records are going to start coming out, I was so excited. But then I was like, 25 years, it felt forever. Turns out it wasn't that, it went pretty fast. But 2017 came and went, and we don't have all the records yet. So this has led to some litigation. But before we get there, we need to unpackage under the act even what exactly is an assassination record. Well, it's a record that's related to the assassination of President Kennedy that was created or made available for use by, obtained or came into the possession of, the commission to investigate the assassination. That would be the Warren Commission, the CIA, the commissions on the CIA activities, the Rockefeller Commission that looked in the 70s on CIA activities, the Church Committee, you may remember that stuff, that was looking at secret CIA behavior that started intersecting with the JFK assassination records, other select committees that were passed, including the one in the 70s where the House Committee, again, the House Assassination Committee, sort of due to the public outcry after the Zapruder film was released in 75, they then held hearings having, you know, the public had seen the Zapruder film, the Church Committee stuff on the CIA had come out. So now the House Select Committee in the late 70s held hearings and came to a conclusion that the Warren Commission was wrong, and they looked at all the evidence and new evidence, and they concluded that there was a conspiracy, although they didn't say who, but they concluded that there were multiple shooters. We've got Library of Congress, presidential libraries, executive agencies, and the like. So in any event, it's very, very broad in terms of records that have been collected, created, or come into possession of all these different government agencies over time. So this brings us to our first case we're going to talk about, which is Morley versus the CIA. It's reported at 894 F 3rd 389, and this is the DC Circuit decision in 2018, but it starts in 2003. And so Morley is a journalist and news editor. In fact, I've gone to his podcast. It's called jfkfacts.org, his website and podcast. He's sort of one of the most famous journalists who sort of tracked and followed, and it's almost a meta site if you want to sort of see everything that's been collected up on JFK and the assassination. And he's been tracking this. I think he's a former lawyer too, or a current lawyer even. But he's been tracking this, and this is his sort of expertise and specialty is on JFK and the assassination records. And so he went and made a FOIA request to the CIA, and he wanted everything related to some guy named George Johannides and what he was doing in the CIA. And he said this is connected to the assassination because we have reason to believe that this CIA person, George, was somehow in Dallas or New Orleans or wherever and was involved. And so the CIA tells him, well, we've given everything to the review board. Go to the review board. The Assassination Act passed, you know, back in 92. We gave everything. We're not looking again. And so they refused to give him anything or go look. He took that up. You know, the district court said, yeah, that's fine. He takes it up on appeal to the DC Circuit. Sorry. The DC Circuit says, no, that's not okay. It goes back. So the CIA goes and looks, and it turns out, well, they didn't give all the records to the review board, it turns out. They found 400 new records, and so those records were handed over to Morley and the CIA. And these records, if we just as a little side note want to talk about them, what the records showed is that this guy, George Johannides, was a CIA case officer working for a Cuban anti-Castro group. And the officers of the Cuban anti-Castro group, who this Johannides was liaising with, those officers were actually in contact with Oswald prior to the assassination. So Oswald's working with some Cuban anti-Castro group, and that group itself has got a liaison with a CIA case officer, and he's creating records, I guess 400 of them or whatnot. And so this got produced. And so he prevailed. And so Morley says, hey, this is a big deal. Like, you didn't give everything you should have given, and I had to bring a FOIA claim. You tried to say that I wasn't even allowed to bring a FOIA claim because it had been preempted. The court denied that. And it turns out you had records, so I want my fees. Goes on a fee request, goes to the district court. District court denies. So he comes back up on appeal again. And this time he says, this is what the DC Circuit had held. And by now, this has been a 15-year piece of litigation given the length of time it takes to gather documents. And there have been other appeals up to the DC Circuit and back. He kept losing the district court, going to the DC Circuit, getting it reversed, going back, losing again, up. It's like a ping pong ball, right? But ultimately, here's what the... It was a split decision, 2-1. Here's what the majority said. The CIA did err, and it had records that weren't given to the board that should have been given. But, given the FOIA request, they thought they'd done things right. Turns out they hadn't. It behaved reasonably at first in rebuffing him and assuming that he was just retreading the same ground. It just turned out they made basically an honest mistake. You're not going to get your fees under the statutory fee provision, so too bad you lose. The dissent, on the other hand, said that the district court here has been reversed literally 4 times in 15 years for its errors. He did achieve a success in securing records that were significant given what they produced, and this is a quote. None of this is to say that Morley's assassination theories necessarily have any merit. The point is that we have twice remanded the case based on the district court's failure to assess properly the public benefit of Morley's FOIA request. In other words, he's shedding light on what's going on here. This is significant and important. He should get fees. But alas, he didn't, because it's very difficult to get fees in these cases against the government, as we can see. So this brings us, let's fast forward a little bit more to the present day, and we're going to come to 2023 and talk about sort of where we are on this assassination records and national security issue, because it spawned more litigation that we're about to look at. And so let's go back to 2017. You remember how the 2017 deadline existed, that everything had to be released. A lot more got released after 92 and between 92 and 2017. But 2017 rolled around and everything had to be released. And so 2017 deadline comes, President Trump was president, and he issued an executive order postponing any release of further documents under that Section 5 standard we talked about. That, in other words, it was President Trump's opinion that if the remaining documents in possession of the government are released, it could somehow be inimical to our intelligence operations, ongoing intelligence operations, foreign relations, security, national security, basically that type of stuff. Which is pretty incredible to think that documents from the early 1960s that probably come out of the CIA's files or the FBI's files in terms of who they were talking to, what they knew and whatnot, it would still be inimical to sort of those types of current security gathering operations. But maybe, who knows? In any event, that's what President Trump said. And President Trump, remember, had campaigned saying he was going to, at some point earlier he had said he's going to release stuff. Turns out, became president, I guess he got to look under the hood and said, no, we're not going to. So he certifies under Section 5, no release. President Biden becomes president. Biden had actually voted for the 92 Act when he was a senator, but he issued the same orders in 21, 22, and 2023. And President Biden's order specifically relied again on this national security certification, and he issued a transparency plan that was a renewal of it. But basically, this transparency plan requires the agencies to create a basis for the release, some event-based, circumstance-based release mechanism, like, you know, maybe one of the people the CIA or the FBI or whoever was talking to back in the early 60s is still alive, so maybe when they're dead, pause there, because the CIA researchers are saying, hold on, if we have to wait until people who may have firsthand knowledge are dead for you to release the documents, now it's too late for us to go interview those people to find out what else they may know. So that, you know, spawns its own problem in terms of a conspiracy theory on a conspiracy theory in terms of not disclosing. But nonetheless, some new documents did come out in 2023, even though, you know, they held on to more of them under the Section 5, they did release another tranche. And here you have on the right a fascinating document that got released in 2023 that's a part of pending now litigation that we're going to talk about. And this is a memo of a CIA agent in the early 1960s, 1962 you see there. And this guy, Ruben Efron, was literally a CIA lawyer, I believe, or CIA agent, CIA analyst worker in 1962. And what was he doing in 1962? He was opening and reading Lee Harvey Oswald's mail as part of his job. So the CIA was well aware of Oswald. He defected to the Soviet Union. And this guy was reading and opening at some point Oswald's mail back and forth with Oswald's mother and others. You can actually look at the full document if you want. We've got a link here to a website where you can go to it and other documents. But I also cut and paste the actual original underlying 1962 memo by the CIA guy that was released in 2023 for you to see there. So you know it's not Peter saying it, it's real. Pretty remarkable, at least to me. It sounds like a pretty remarkable fact, but who knows what it means? That's in the eye of beholders. But other documents are still withheld. And so let's just do a quick pause here and take a really quick look at why this is significant to assassination research theorists and the like. And here we have the actual Warren Commission testimony from Helms and McCone, two CIA employees at the time. And this is from the Warren Commission. It's volume 5, it's pages 121 to 127. You can get them online. I cut and paste this in here. I didn't edit it at all. But you basically have Helms saying, on behalf of Mr. McCone, I had all of our CIA, that is, records searched to see if there had been any contacts at any prior time to President Kennedy's assassination by anyone in the CIA with Lee Harvey Oswald. We checked our card files, our personnel files, and all our records. Now, this check turned out to be negative. Now, you just saw that memo, right? So this is why people are concerned who look at this stuff today, because they say the Warren Commission may have been given a faulty record. He goes on. In addition, I got in touch with those officers who were in positions of responsibility at the Times and questioned to see if anybody had any recollection of any contact having ever been suggested with this man. This also turned out to be negative. So there is no material in the CIA agency, either in the records or in the mind of the individuals, that there was any contact had or even contemplated with him. Maybe that was a true statement, but it was awfully cute wordsmithing in light of that document we've seen and other CIA-related information that's come out over time. McCone says, I think the exchange between the CIA and the FBI or the Secret Service is adequate. I'm not informed as to whether the exchange between the Secret Service and FBI are equally adequate. Not gone into that. I'd have no means to know. Mr. Dulles being the former CIA director who was fired by John F. Kennedy after the Bay of Pigs disaster. Dulles was then one of the members on the Warren Commission. And so Dulles now says, looking back now that you have the full record, do you feel that you have received from the State Department adequate information at the time that if they are aware of Oswald's defection and later activities in the Soviet Union, did you get at the time full information from the State Department on those subjects? Well, I'm not sure that we got full information. The fact is we had very little information. And then Mr. Helms goes on later, a little bit later in the testimony, around 127, I think the last quote comes from. In order to answer this question precisely, I'd have to look, have the file in front of me. I have not looked at it in some time, so I don't have all that's clearly in mind. But it's my impression that we were not informed step by step. When I say that there is no requirement that I'm aware of that the State Department should inform us, and when I say a moment ago that we had minimal information from them, this was not in any way a sense, a critical comment, but a statement of fact. So in other words, in multiple places, what they were saying is that they had very, very minimal information. They had no information, really. No one had been talking to, engaged with, checking, following Oswald. It was sort of like, Oswald, who's Oswald, right? That's the message, essentially, that was given. Now, you saw that document that came out in 2023, and over the intervening decades, many other documents and testimony and that type of stuff has come out showing that actually the CIA seemed to have more on Oswald and knew about Oswald, as did the FBI. Before the assassination of President Kennedy, this, of course, has raised questions about whether the record that the Warren Commission either was given, created, curated, however you want to believe it all went down, but that record was improper, unduly narrow, and so probably, you know, this is why people believe that there's other explanations, according other than the Warren Commission. Well, this brings us, as you see on our slide here now, to what does this all mean in the context of litigation in the 92 Act, the JFK Act? And we have the Mary Farrell Foundation versus Biden. This is a 2023 lawsuit filed in the Northern District of California. And so basically, the Mary Farrell Foundation is the largest electronic database of searchable JFK assassination records. And the link that I gave you on that prior slide to the document is to the Mary Farrell Foundation page. You go there, they've taken essentially everything that's been released, digitized it, you can search it. It's really fascinating and fun if you want to noodle around in there sometimes. But in any event, they sued in 2022 after President Biden issued that Section 5 certification, and they filed this lawsuit to force the disclosure and to force the turnover of all these documents and to cease further holdbacks by the government. And they also sued to get a better records age for the research. In other words, the stuff as being released by the government was too hard to cross-reference and understand, and the law actually required that it be disclosed with good research aids for researchers so they can understand even what they're getting. And they also sued because they wanted all the legislative records to be turned over because those still hadn't been turned over. Government moves to dismiss, and this is where we are today. We have a motion to dismiss, and as to the first claim, that is, you need to turn over everything and you can no longer hold anything back. The district court held the president can very rarely, if ever, be enjoined unless he's really engaged in purely ministerial duties. But what the court held here is the decision as to whether a tranche of documents sit behind a Section 5 determination of national security, that's not ministerial. That's entirely discretionary to the government, and it's based on their judgment, the executive's judgment. And when they make the conclusion that a withholding is necessary due to an identifiable national security harm, that's not subject to judicial review, period. And so the result of that is that you don't get to sue and challenge a Section 5 determination. It's sort of absolute, unreviewable, and that's what the district court has held as of 2023. Now, as to the second claim, that the finding aids that were being given by the government are inadequate and not kept properly. In other words, they're unduly confusing or useless and you can't figure out what stuff is or how to cross-reference it properly. As to that claim, the government said, you may have stated a claim at least to survive a Rule 12 motion, and so we'll let that keep going. You'll stand. And then as to the third claim, and this may be the most important sort of part of the ruling thus far, the district court held that the president's Section 5 power to withhold only applies to executive agencies. And so a national security certification can only engraft onto a statement, for example, by the FBI or the CIA or some other executive agency that a national security interest exists. Legislative records, it doesn't engraft onto. So for example, if there's a host of records that one of those, the church committee or the assassination unactivity assassination committee in the late 70s looked at and had a bunch of records that are still being withheld that would be legislative related, those may get turned over. Stay tuned because this litigation is ongoing. It's in the district court. It will be up to the Ninth Circuit. You know, we will have to see what happens, but it certainly prompted, you know, more motions to be filed, more battles to be filed about the urgency of getting access to some of these documents and the names of the witnesses so that they can be interviewed before they die, as I had alluded to earlier. And that's all pending in the trial courts now. In a future Curious Lawyer program, we may be able to tell you more about what's happened here. So stay tuned. The JFK assassination records drama will go on. So let's go back to JFK now and that scene. You remember the scene I showed you? Garrison was walking off the screen. All looked well. But what happened really? Remember, Garrison lost at trial. And here's what matters, because this didn't come out in the Oliver Stone movie. But one of the key witnesses at trial was a guy named Russo. Now, Russo was not even used in the trial. There was a character called Willie O'Keefe that Oliver Stone used as sort of one of the testifying witnesses, and that was an amalgam of several people, apparently. But here's what Russo actually said at the trial. Originally, he had said to newspapers that the guy Ferry, and you may remember from the movie Ferry was Dave with Joe Pesci. So Joe Pesci says to this guy Russo that they were going to kill John F. Kennedy. But he also said to the press that he had never heard of the name Oswald. Now, Garrison then interviewed him, and he tells Garrison that he saw someone with Joe Pesci, Ferry, who looked like Oswald. But he couldn't remember exactly. He said if he could be hypnotized, maybe he could remember more. So Garrison literally hypnotizes Russo via sodium pentothal, which to me sounds horrendous and unimaginable. I thought that was one of those crazy CIA, like, truth serum drugs that they did in black sites and whatnot. But in any event, they literally hypnotize this guy Russo. This is a DA. And while hypnotized, he says that Ferry, Joe Pesci, Shaw, that was the other famous actor, I'm blanking on his name now, but anyway, Ferry and Shaw, the main one on trial, and Oswald all discussed killing JFK. And so he says that while he's, Tommy Lee Jones, sorry, it was Shaw. So he says that, you know, Joe Pesci, Tommy Lee Jones, and Oswald, they discussed killing JFK, they told me about it. So he's given a polygraph, he fails a polygraph, but nonetheless, he gets used at trial by Garrison, who puts this guy on the witness stand. On the witness stand at trial, he goes south. It's a disaster. He doesn't say any of that stuff, and it's just a total mess, right? So, you know, what happened after the trial, though, is Garrison lost, but Garrison didn't let go. He then charged Shaw, who had won the trial, with perjury. And his basic perjury charge was that you lied at trial when you denied having done all this stuff and you won in front of the jury. And the reason I know you lied is because Russo had said all that stuff before. Shaw now is apoplectic, obviously, and so he basically sues in federal civil court, civil rights action, saying, it's not okay, I'm now being harassed. The district court holds a three-day hearing where Russo shows up and asserts the Fifth Amendment at this point, and the district court just quashes the prosecution and says this is brought in bad faith and for purposes of harassment. Garrison appeals. What happens? Here we have the Fifth Circuit, 1972. The extreme measures the state resorted to in extracting information from Russo and the use of his testimony at the trial were incompatible with the American system of justice. Whoa, that's a harsh statement, right? The state's case against Shaw for conspiracy to assassinate President Kennedy turned on Russo. No one knew better than Garrison how unreliable Russo was. If he ever had any faith in Russo's credibility, it must have vanished when he heard Russo testify. And then they go on to say it's a fair inference that he knew Russo would be ineffective in the second perjury trial. Moreover, considering also the extreme lengths to which Garrison went for the purpose of proving his case, it's a fair inference that he well knew Russo would take the fifth. And then the big quote, there's no basis for Garrison's initial interrogation of Shaw. In other words, Garrison should never have even been talking to Shaw to begin with. So here we have, and they didn't give you this postscript in the JFK movie. It wouldn't have fit with sort of hero walking off into the sunlight with his family. That's a pretty brutal beatdown by an American court coming out of the Fifth Circuit, a district court and a circuit court, saying there was no basis to have ever talked to Shaw to begin with. Garrison takes it up to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court denies cert. And that brings us then to the end of, perhaps that's the epilogue to the JFK movie. Now you know what happened and how prosecutorial overreach, one has to be careful going too far. A final little quick sidebar here will be on the Sherman Act and John F. Kennedy. The Sherman Act, as you remember, prohibits contracts that restrain trade. Courts use a rule of reason, as you see here, which basically says that it only applies to unreasonable restraints. And so they look at the relevant market, the existence of anti-competitive effects by behavior, and what's the intent and the like. So let's take a look at what happened, because here you got a picture of Judge Grimm on the next slide here, who confronted an NFL antitrust case. And basically the NFL took all the broadcast rights to all the different games that were in the then nascent NFL, pooled them and sold them to CBS, and CBS was going to pay an annual fee that would be then divided among the teams. Okay, this then gets litigated by the DOJ saying this isn't an anti-competitive, you're pooling all the rights, you're taking away the rights of individual clubs to negotiate and sell how they want, antitrust violation. And Judge Grimm says clearly this is an antitrust violation. You're precluding the clubs from telecasting games themselves. And so he issues an injunction saying you cannot pool the rights and have all these rights sold exclusively on a national level to CBS that would then play all the games in all of our homes all across the country. Instead, each team should be able to sell however it wants in each market. Great public outcry, apparently, because Judge Grimm's ruling, as you see on this slide here, was in 1961, July 20th. There's an immediate lobbying effort. The Senate's holding hearings in August of 1961, 1 month later. And then a month later, they pass a bill, basically undoing the ruling of Judge Grimm. So literally in the space of 2 months from Judge Grimm's ruling to September 30th, hearings are held, a bill is passed, and it turns out that Judge Grimm's ruling is reversed, and joint agreements among people engaged in conducting organized professional sports can engage in those types of pooled rights contracts. This is the Sports Broadcasting Act, and there you've got John F. Kennedy's signature. He signed it into law within 2 months. Incredible example of how much, I guess, we love sports or the power of lobbies back then. And that brings us to the modern day, where we have sports every weekend, every day, and it's on a national level in all markets, games being broadcast. And largely it's owing to the enactment of this law that took away the individual rights of the individual teams to sell how they want. So that brings us to the end of today's Curious Lawyer program. We saw and learned today, as you see on our conclusions, about copyright and fair use. We learned about who's the author of a work, but the great exceptions for federal creations that are within the course and scope of employment, not subject to copyright. We saw the fascinating Fifth Amendment takings issue as it applies both to the Zapruder film, but also to the Oswald rifle. And along the way, I think we had a little bit of fun with our sidebars on the First Amendment and the antitrust laws. Given to us by JFK's signature. Meanwhile, we saw prosecutorial overreach, and it led to a serious ruling by the Fifth Circuit against Garrison. And so what this also leads to then is that JFK movies inspired JFK's act demand for everything to be released by 2017. It hasn't happened yet, but it may well happen in time. Stay tuned, and let's see if in our lifetimes we get all those documents. Thank you for watching this program. As ever, email me if you have any questions.